God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. Now, I know what you might be thinking. There are some desires that don't feel very godly. But sin doesn't lie at the core of what we want or need. Rather, sin is the result of trying to meet a need in the wrong manner. Mark chapter 7, verses 18 through 22, and Ephesians chapter 2, and verses 1 through 3, detail that evil thoughts and desires come from within fallen man themselves. That after the fall, the power and dominance of the flesh, that is our fallen human nature, has led us to walk in accordance to the sinful atmosphere that God presses upon us. Next slide. Next slide. Right there. Perfect. So, Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 2 calls Satan the prince of the power of the air. But in the context, it's written and it's meant that Satan controls the spiritual atmosphere that we're exposed to. Satan controls our spiritual atmosphere. The spirit now worketh in the children of disobedience, Ephesians 2:2. Satan would have our desires be corrupted by teaching us to disobey God. And if he can't do that, he'll try to teach us to deny or remain ignorant of our Heavenly Father, who gave us our wants and desires to begin with. God only wants nothing more than to meet our wants and desires in ways that are pure and lasting, as God has always intended for us. Now that we've quickly brushed over the difference between God's perfect design and the way that Satan tries to corrupt that design, let's begin the message. This message will begin at the introduction of David as a shepherd and the youngest child in his father's house. If you could turn with me, please all turn to 1 Samuel chapter 16. Now, in the previous chapter, this is just a little bit of background. King Saul's right to rule God's people was revoked after deliberately disobeying the direct command by God. God told Saul he would get a great victory, he's going to battle the Amalekites. He goes out, they have a great victory, but God says, don't take any of the spoils after this victory. Saul feared that the people might think of him, as weak or less than if he didn't allow them to take the goods of the Amalekites. And for respecting the opinion of man over the opinion of God, his right to rule was revoked. Chapter 16 begins with the mourning of Samuel over Saul. Saul is now lost his kingship. God's first anointed king over Israel and Judah, who he first anointed. Samuel has just been instructed to take up his horn and anoint a new king. And this is found among the sons of Jesse, the Bethlehemite. Among the sons of Jesse, it is Eliab, the eldest son, that first catches Samuel's attention. Now, Eliab was a tall guy, handsome guy, looked like a king, talked like a king. So when Samuel is called to go get a new king, he sees the eldest boy of Jesse, who looks really the most like Saul to him, and he thinks this is him. In Samuel's eyes, Eliab seemed the most likely successor. But God sees the heart. God knew David's heart, the heart of a good shepherd and the makings of a great king. But he also knew the heart of Saul, the child of disobedience and the spirit that would eventually corrupt his heart. God chose a new king, seeing kingship in the youngest son, who both Samuel and then his own dad overlooked. Saul's calling was canceled, and David's new calling was confirmed. David was God's newly anointed king now. And as the Spirit of the Lord poured out upon David, an evil spirit began to take hold of Saul's heart. But isn't God merciful? Even after we disobey him, it just so happened that the newly anointed shepherd boy, David, was also a really talented harpist. He was a good musician. David's skill and reputation recommended him to become King Saul's personal musician. And the sound of the harp freed Saul from an evil spirit that was tormenting him. And so David was called to minister unto the king through music. Do you know that your gifts and your talents, no matter how small, can have a mighty purpose? Where is God positioning you? David was a shepherd, then he was plunged to become a musician to the king. But don't think that just because God is elevating you to a new position, this is going to be comfortable. Just after, David was recommended to become the musician to Saul, but not without reason. David, before he slew any type of Goliath, had a lot of good characteristics that he'd been cultivating in God. Did you know that way before David ever killed Goliath, he was known to be a cunning and plain, a valiant man, a man of war, prudent in manners, or basically good at making wise decisions, handsome, and the Lord was with him. This one kind of struck me when I was going through this, is that David was seen already as a valiant man and a man of war. Now, before he killed Goliath, no one really sees him as a man of war, a valiant man, but he had those qualities already. The character of David was cultivated, and that soil that he laid out for his life allowed God to grow a great calling. But remember, calling is not always comfortable. Saul may have loved David when he was a harp player. He may have even loved him after he killed Goliath. But two chapters after he killed Goliath, he was throwing javelins at David and just like stabbed him to a wall. So you might not like your boss at work, but Saul was the worst boss, let me tell you. But David was steadfast to his calling, no matter what form it took. Truly God's anointed, he was dedicated to the service of God throughout all the fantastic transitions of his life. Shepherd, to harp player, to the king. But you know, we just uncovered how he went from shepherd to harp player, and then he was anointed to be king. But the next transition in David's journey is the one that's always been kind of tricky for me. At least, I don't really like the way it's been told so far. It's his transition from being a shepherd, musician, to a warrior. This is the story of David and Goliath. Famous as it may be, I think the story has been presented all wrong. Sure, David may have been an unexpected hero, but I don't think he was an unlikely one at all. But time and time again, on the pulpit, in literature and movies alike, this story has been made that David is some sort of an underdog. But when we see a picture like this, it's not hard to see why. But appearances can be deceiving. And David being an underdog is just not something I believe anymore. So let's turn to the text. Was David really an underdog, or was he just a champion that was unexpected? Saul, a man of war, didn't think he could do it. Goliath, also a man of war, doubted him. But let's put the text to the test. If he was an underdog, let's weigh out the disadvantages. And if he was an unexpected champion, let's search how he caught two seasoned men of war off guard as far as his ability to win. Turn with me to 1 Samuel chapter 17. And I'm going to kind of do the modern age thing. I don't want to carry a Bible and a clicker, so I'll go and use my phone Bible. So, let me paint this scene, all right? The Philistines were gathered together, and they're on one side of this mountain. And then the Israelites are on a whole other side of the mountain. So it's a valley, right? We're in the Silicon Valley, except at the valley, it wasn't technology, it was like bloodshed and war. So Saul and all the men of Israel gathered there on one side. They set their armies in array, and it's looking really cool. And the Philistines did the same thing on the other side. But then, in big battles like this, it was advantageous not to just have bodies versus bodies and, you know, have a bloodbath. Instead, they would send their best. That would save, I mean, there's been a lot of battles that all Israel has done, and people died by thousands. So they came up with a solution, and that's send your best, right? So the Philistines send out Goliath. And there's this champion out of the camp of the Philistines of Gath, who is 6 cubits in a span. Now, when I say 6 cubits in a span, that doesn't sound like much. But let me tell you this, 6 cubits in a span was 9'9". Think about the tallest basketball player you could think of. He at least had 2 feet on him. Okay, this guy was big. He didn't even need a jump to dunk, okay? All right, so this guy's 6 cubits in span, and he has a helmet of brass upon his head, and he's armed with a coat of mail. And the weight of the coat of the mail was 5,000 shekels of brass. Again, what is a shekel? Let's talk about poundage. This guy's armor was 125 pounds. I look like I'm a normally sized, normally whatever man. I'm actually super, super light. I'm 125 pounds. His armor was me. Okay? That's kind of crazy, right? So, and he had greaves of brass on his legs, a target of brass on his shoulders, so basically just a big, like, almost like a shield for your back. And the staff of his spear was like a weaver's beam. Weaver's beam, someone's sitting down, and this thing is super long. You get the point. But the spearhead of his spear, just the spear, was 15 pounds. Okay, this guy is a man of war that is tall as he is beefy. Okay, this guy, spears are not a slow type of weapon. This guy needs to be able to wield this spear with speed, and he's wielding something this heavy with speed. And he went before the Israelites, and he cried and said to the armies of Israel, "Why you come to set your battle in array? Am I not a Philistine, and ye servants to Saul? Choose you a man, and let him come down to me. If he be able to fight me, and to kill me," this is verse 9, whoever's following, "then will we be your servants, but I will prevail against him, and kill him, then shall ye be our servants and serve us." And the Philistine says, "I defy the army of Israel today, and give me a man that will be fighting again." Now Saul and all of ancient Israel, they're like, this guy is huge. We're going to be slaves if we lose. So they're scared. It says they were dismayed and greatly afraid. Now David was the son of Jesse, and Jesse was an old man at this time. He had 8 sons, but he sent out his 3 eldest to battle. So they go out and they follow Saul to battle, and David the youngest, he was the harp player to Saul, but at this time during battle time, he goes back to take care of the sheep that he was originally in charge of. Technical difficulties. But he's taking care of this sheep, and his dad starts to get worried, okay? And rightfully so, he has 3 of his eldest boys out in battle. But he wants to figure out what the status is on the battlefront. So he asks David to go bring food to the Israelites and bring cheeses to the generals and just basically get word of what's going on, see the status, come back. So David gladly does this, obeys his dad. But now Goliath has been doing his challenge saying, "Bring someone," for 40 days. Okay? But as David comes out, and let me see if I can find. Alright. So now Saul and all the men of Israel, they're in the valley and they're fighting with the Philistines. And David rose up early in the morning and left the sheep with a keeper. And he went as his dad commanded him. For Israel and the Philistines had put their battle in array against army. And David led the carriage with the keeper. As he talked with them, he ran up to meet the army. And he's basically checking to see what's going on. As he talked with them, Goliath came down and he issued the same challenge. "Bring someone, I defy the armies of God." This time David's in hearing range of what Goliath's saying. So now he's speaking to him now. And all the men of Israel, when they saw Goliath, they fled from him. And they're saying, "Have you seen this guy who came up? He's David asks, who is this guy? And the king has now issued a prize for whoever wins the fight against Goliath. And he says, whoever shall come up and defeat Goliath, the king will enrich him with great riches, give him his daughter, and make his father's house free in Israel. Rent free. Think about what rent free looks like in California. Okay. David spake to the man that stood by him and said, is this really going to happen? Will someone really get all this stuff? For who is this uncircumcised Philistine that should defy the armies of the living God? And there's a prize for me taking down this guy? And the people answer him and say, yes, there's a prize for taking down Goliath. So Eliab hears his little brother's voice. And it says, when he heard David, his anger was kindled against David. He says, why did you come here? He says, why camest thou hither? And with whom did you leave the sheep in the wilderness? He says, leave those few sheep in the wilderness. He's, you know, older brothers kind of trying to dig it into you. He says, I know thy pride and the naughtiness of your heart, for thou art come down that you could see battle. His big brother knew that he wanted to fight in a battle. But David said, what have I done now? He literally says, what have I now done? Is there not a cause? I know they had this conversation before. And he turned from him and turns from his brother, ignores what his brother says, and says, basically, is this really good? Like, there's a prize for this, and there's no one that challenged him. And the words that David was saying, the other army members heard this, and they're like, wow, there's somebody that's willing to face Goliath. So they bring it to Saul. And Saul brings David to him. He says, let no man's heart fail because of him. Thy servant will go and fight the Philistine. And Saul says, you aren't able to go against the Philistine and fight him, for you are but a youth, and this is a man from his youth. But David said, thy servant kept my father's sheep. And there came a lion and a bear that took the lamb out of the flock. And I went out after him and smote him and delivered it out of his mouth. And when he rose against me, I caught him by his beard and smote him and slew him. Thy servant slew both the lion and the bear, and this uncircumcised Philistine will be just as one of them, seeing he hath defied the armies of the living God. David said, the Lord that delivered me out of the lion and out of the bear's hand will also deliver me out of the Philistine's hand. So Saul, he's like, you know what? That's probably the realest statement I ever heard. Let's put the kid up. So he says, go and the Lord be with you. And Saul armed David with his armor and put a helmet on his head and armed him with his own coat of mail. And David put the sword on and he tried to walk and he realized, whoa, this is heavier than I'm used to. I'm used to shepherd's clothes. And he said, I can't go with this. I haven't proved it. So he took the armor off, told Saul, I haven't proved any of this. So he took his staff in his hand that he's used to, took 5 smooth stones out of the brook and put them in a shepherd's bag, and a sling in his hand, and he drew near the Philistine. So, a couple things to kind of note about David. He was willing to test out Saul's armor, but since he didn't prove it, he's like, let me stick to something I know. And then he prepared with 5 stones, so he's like, I come prepared. I want to make sure I have enough ammo just in case something gets dicey. And the Philistine came on and drew near unto David, and the man that bare the shield went before him. And the Philistine looks at David, and he had disdain for him. He's like, who is this little kid? For he was but a youth, ruddy and of fair countenance. So he still had a baby face, still had the boyish charm. And the Philistine said unto David, am I a dog that you come with me with staves or with sticks? And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. And the Philistine said to David, come to me, and I will give thy flesh to the fowls of the air and the beasts of the field. Now Goliath is starting to diss David, and he's starting to diss his God. So David says, nope, you come with me with a sword and with a spear and with a shield, but I come in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom thou hast defied. Now, David brought up Goliath's rap sheet. He says, you have a sword on your waist, you have a big spear, and you have a big shield. He didn't mention once that he had a staff or his stones or his sling. He didn't talk about his earthly weapon. He talked about the only weapon that mattered. He talked about God. He says, "This day the Lord will deliver thee into mine hand, and I will smite thee, and take thine hand from thee. And I will give the carcasses of the hosts of the Philistines this day to the fowls of the air and the beasts of the earth, that they may know that there is a God in Israel." So it came to pass after this that the Philistine Goliath comes up, and it says that David ran. He hastened to meet Goliath. Real quick, why do you think Goliath said, "Why do you come with me with staves?" He had a sling and he had a staff. Let me ask another question. What is this? Does anyone know what this is?
Sword.
What is it used for?
Killing.
What is this? What is it used for? What's this? What is it used for? Let me challenge that. Because we just were talking about earlier when David was Saul's harpist. He used this harp to win a spiritual battle when a demonic presence was torturing Saul. So this is a weapon, and it's used for battle. How about this? What's this?
Staff.
A staff, what's it used for?
Take care of sheep.
Taking care of sheep? What else?
Protecting
the sheep. I like that. What about this here?
Sling.
A sling, what's it used for? To destroy. You recognize that when you look at it, right? When Goliath saw this right here, and this right here, he didn't see a weapon. He's like, "That's a stick. Those are some stones. What are you going to do with those?" Right? So David runs up. This kind of talks about the character of David, because when Goliath comes up, it says that David runs up to meet him. It says, hasten to meet the Philistine, and David put in his hand the bag and took thence a stone and he slang it. So what kind of weapon is a sling? Is it a close range weapon? Is it a long range weapon?
Long range.
Long range weapon. Why did he run up on Goliath? Goliath's a big guy. If it were me, I kind of want to shoot her from afar, right? But David, he's made of different stuff than I am. He's courageous beyond all imagining. Do you remember the story we talked about, the bear and the lion? He said when the lion and the bear snatched the lamb up from his herd, it says that he smote the bear and the lion, and when the lamb was freed, that when the bear and the lion on those two separate occasions tried to attack him, that he grabbed it by its beard and smote it to death. What type of weapon again is a sling? Long range. Why would he be so close to a bear or a lion to smite it up close? One, he wasn't scared, but two, think about a hostage situation, okay? Let's say I take Virgil and I'm like, "Hey, nobody move, right?" Would it be smart for me to like try to shoot him? When he has a hostage, it's kind of dangerous. If this shows the heart of David, David wants to make sure to protect and save his sheep in a safe manner. God, he isn't afraid to get his hands dirty and get up close and personal in order to save his sheep. This is, I think, why God says that David is a man after his own heart, because David's heart looks like his heart. Jesus is someone who's willing to get close in order to free you. So he took this stone in his hand, he took this sling, he slung it, and he smote the Philistine on his forehead, and the stone sunk into his forehead, and he fell on the face of the earth. So David prevailed over the Philistine with a sling and with a sword, and he smote the Philistine and slew him, but there was no sword in the hand of David. So he ran, and he took Goliath's sword, and he chopped his head off, and all the Philistines flee, and it's a great victory. So I don't know if you guys are following along with the story, but this is just kind of some of the little sub-points I got as far as David's character goes. We talked about how Goliath's 9'9", super swole, really great fighter. David had a passion to serve the Lord. David was brave enough to take a lion and a bear up close in order to rescue one lamb. He tried and tested his God-given abilities when he faced a lion and a bear. And David was prepared by taking 5 stones. He only used 1 stone to kill Goliath, but he took 5 stones. He was prepared and had the skill to kill the giant. When David runs up on Goliath, this tells me that he knew with full confidence he would win this fight. And he did have a certain skill set, but he didn't think that the stone gave him the victory. He said, "I serve a God that's in heaven." Real quick to note, Saul didn't know what a sling or a staff was as far as warfare went, and neither did Goliath. But after this, David proved these as weapons of war. He proved them. When he wore the armor and the sword of Saul, and he said, "I can't go with this because I haven't proved it," he had a new way of fighting warfare. Do you guys know anything about mathematical proofs? It's something that after you've displayed that it's valid or it works, you can continue to reproduce it. David, after using a sling to beat Goliath, proved that slings were an effective tool for warfare. Let's talk about the legacy of slings, okay? Real quick. The shepherd's sling became regularly utilized in warfare. It's been used since 2500 BC. And just so you know, this isn't like a little slingshot that you might get when you're a little kid. This is like a rope and a whole finger to sway, and you can sling this rock up to, some slings can sling a rock up to 100 miles per hour, and has the caliber, like the impact, the force of a 44 Magnum. So, talk about bringing a gun to a sword fight. I mean, it's like Saul was like, "You can't beat this guy." David's like, "I can beat this guy. I beat a lion and a bear, trust me." David had the character, he had the skills, but these are the main two things that I think were the key to his victory. David knew that God's victory had little to do with the weapon in his hand, but more to do with the wielder who's proven the weapon. David proved that the weapon was effective by God. And he had the mighty rock in his corner. He conquered David with a rock, but he also had the mighty rock in his corner. The point is, no one knew that the shepherd's sling would be regularly utilized as a weapon for battle. David used his unique experiences, gifts, and talents he developed in a mighty way. What gifts and talents do you have? What interests you? How have you used those gifts so far? God may have already proved some of your gifts as a powerful use for spiritual warfare, as well as actual battle. After all, with his skill in battle assigned, David's musical inclination allowed him to regularly provide sanity to Saul, who was dealing with his own spiritual warfare. We talked about how Saul tried to kill David time and time again, but the mercy that David showed Saul in those times where Saul tried to kill him, remember what David was originally called to do. He was ministering onto Saul. He was literally the mercy or the grace that God gave to Saul after he disobeyed him. So David was already trained up to show mercy to Saul. But David's musical inclination, of course, freed Saul, and his poems live on today. David may have been a cool shepherd slinger, but after he proved this, we find that 700 choice men out of Israel took up the sling because they realized it was a good weapon. And it said each one could sling a stone, like the pros, each one could sling a stone at a hair and not miss. Talk about skills. What can you accomplish with the mighty rock in your corner? Real quick, if you guys have a phone, take a picture of that see how God is a mighty rock. But I know this sermon had a lot going on. If you'd allow me, I didn't want to end this sermon without talking about Jesus real quick. Is it okay if I talk about the mighty rock? Okay. First Samuel chapter 2 and verse 2 says, "There is none holy like the Lord, for there is none beside thee, neither is any rock like our God." So, the true and eternal king, David may have been a king, but the true and eternal king was Jesus. He also had humble beginnings like David. David was a shepherd, Jesus was a carpenter, and he was also an unexpected hero. He was unexpected hero to the people of his time, despite all the prophecies of his coming. He was born in a manger, he was visited by strangers at his birth, was a carpenter's son, had nothing special to look at as far as his appearance went, and was not the savior king that people were looking for. But Jesus is the good shepherd who would leave the 99 for one. He said, "What man of you, having 100 sheep, if he lose one of them, doth leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after that which is lost until he find it? And when he hath found it, he layeth on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he come, he calleth together his friends and neighbors, saying unto them, Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep which was lost." That's Luke chapter 15, verse 4-6. And yet he was still rejected by the religious elite. He was murdered innocently, hung to a tree in the most brutal fashion ever seen for crucifixion. In Deuteronomy chapter 2 and verse, or in Deuteronomy chapter 21, verses 22-23, Mosaic law teaches that there's an eternal curse placed upon those who are hanged from a tree. Those that were hanged by a tree were put out of the congregation before they were set on a tree, symbolically to die the second death. In so doing, their names were symbolically blotted out of the book of life. Galatians chapter 3 and verse 13 says, "Christ hath redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. For it is written, Cursed is everyone that hangs from a tree." The curse began on a tree. You guys remember the Garden of Eden? It was answered by a tree, Jesus on the cross. And ultimately, it will be removed by a tree in eternity, the tree of life. So why was Jesus placed in the position, occupation, upbringing, and skill set he was given? He was a carpenter, right? Besides fulfilling prophecy, the Father knew we needed a Savior who was in the business of finding purpose in nails and trees. Amen. Praise God for a Savior that knows what it's like to be overlooked, and praise God for a God that would become a curse so we can undo curses. Our histories hold weapons and generational curses that he'll undo with you if you let him. Give your gifts and watch what he'll do with you. Goliath didn't know a weapon when he saw it, and neither did Satan when he conspired to kill Jesus. He never knew what hit him. Jesus hung from a tree to make your curse a key. He holds the keys to set you free. Thank you. Now, we're going to have our closing hymn. It's going to be, "Oh Come All Ye Faithful."